Michael Young is a financial guru and a commodities trader and certainly knows an awful lot about the economy yesterday, today, and tomorrow. And he's with us right here on Public Exposure. Michael, welcome back to the show.
Nice to see you again, Stan.
Well, okay. So just how good is the economy? The jobs report just recently came out. The
president said it's really fine.
Well,
so we know that may not be true. The economy is, there's some growth happening. I mean, GDP is plugging along at about 1.5%, mm-hmm. and the economy is growing jobs. The last report, you know, adjusted was around 90,000 in terms of real jobs added to the economy on a month-to-month basis. The problem is that the economy is not growing fast enough to really add the number of jobs we need to replace what was lost from 2008 to 2009. And that's a major issue for the economy.
Shouldn't we just admit that those days are gone?
Well, yeah, we might have to admit that they're gone. And the bigger issue is that nobody asked this question, but I think it's pretty relevant when they say, well, we created 90,000 jobs this month. But nobody talks about what those jobs pay. And the bulk of those jobs don't pay enough for a family of four to live on. And if you look at what was released from the Census Bureau this week, which was shocking statistics in my opinion, from 07 to 2011, the net worth of the average American family dropped from $228,000 to $174,000. So their net worth was cut by something like 45%. Wow. And net incomes at the same time, the net incomes in the country fell by about $4,000 a year. So against this backdrop, and particularly the segment that was really hurt was the age group 25 to 44. So those people are the backbone of what we need for economic growth in the country. And they simply aren't earning enough money to fuel the kind of growth that we would need. And it particularly shows up in housing, where mm-hmm. we're still struggling to get anything close to even 500,000 starts, which is pretty dismal to begin with. But even that is very difficult for the economy to achieve.
Let's go to that demographic group that you were talking about, the ages 25 to 44, that their income drastically went down.
Correct.
Here's what I'm thinking. In a few years, they're not going to be 44 anymore. They're going to be 55 or they're going to be 60, and they're going to be nearing retirement age. They're probably not going to be able to retire, but if they don't have a job, who's going to support them?
Well, that is a major issue, not only for that generation, but for the boomers that are retiring now. Mm-hmm. I turn 60 next year, unfortunately, and I'm going to be retiring sometime between 65 and 70 if I'm on a normal trajectory. My wife is going to retire sometime soon. There's a ton of our generation, a lot of us, who are going to be, you know, changing over from what we've been doing to something else. And there's just not enough people or enough income to sustain the payments, the transfer payments that the government's promised us. So this is going to be a major issue. What is really surprising is in this presidential campaign, the two major candidates running for president, neither one are talking about the problem of Social Security and how we fund the transfer programs and how we make sure that happens. And politicians running for the U.S. Senate and the congressional races, I don't hear any talk about this major issue for the American people. It's almost non-existent.
Well, but I hear one side saying that, you know, we have paid into it, so it's okay. And the funds are there. We just shouldn't borrow against it. And people have been talking about that for a long time. Others are saying, hey, we need to take a percentage of it, although they're not saying this as much anymore. We need to take a percentage of it and allow it to be invested privately.
The problem is that it wasn't invested. The problem is the taxes that were paid, the Social Security taxes went directly into the Treasury. Once they got to the Treasury, there was no division of those dollars. They were spent. And in their stead, in the Social Security Trust Fund, are now government bonds that are issued by the government. And so it's kind of like they have taken the money and spent it, and now they have this major problem about how to make up the transfers, and nobody has an answer yet of how to do it. And the answer is going to be, obviously, you're going to have to raise your retirement age and cut benefits. There's no other way around it.
There are many, many economists that say that we shouldn't really worry about debt too much.
It depends on how large the debt is. You don't have to worry about it until you can't pay it back.
Well, we Europe's
now experiencing that particular problem. And it also becomes a problem when the interest payments are larger than what you have in your budget. And the United States will be very shortly spending close to 50 cents on every dollar it takes in on interest income. So it does become a problem.
Well, I am sufficiently depressed now, and it's only been 4 minutes into the show, Michael. Just a little bit about your background. You work in commodities, right?
Right. We trade futures. That's what we do for a living.
And how long have you been doing that?
Since about 1982.
Wow. So for, 30 years now, trading futures.
Exactly.
Would you prefer to trade the past?
Yes. It's much easier. It's always easier looking backwards. It's much harder to determine, you know, what will happen in the future. And then things happen like you would not expect, like I would never have dreamed that the Federal Reserve would finance 68% of federal spending from 08 to today. The Federal Reserve has literally bought 68% of the American debt. That's why interest rates didn't rise, in spite of all this massive borrowing.
All right, help me understand that. How is it that the Federal Reserve has funded our 68% of our government?
Okay, Congress went out and spent, let's just make it easy. Let's say the federal budget, just to make it easy, is $1 trillion.
Okay.
They raised that money, that $1 trillion that they're about to spend, they raised through taxes and through borrowing. And when they can't borrow it without impacting rates, the Fed would step in and buy the difference. So every time they'd come to an auction with securities, the Fed would stand in the auction and bid and take down a certain amount of the auction. And they were able to do that successfully by expanding the Fed's balance sheet by this incredible number and keeping long rates low, which the objective of the policy was to try to restart the economy from an extremely leveraged position so that rates didn't rise and choke off whatever nascent recovery was underway. It's very dangerous because when you monetize that level of spending, it does two things. You risk massive amounts of inflation down the road, but two, there's a moral hazard in that there's no check on Congress to stop spending. They continue to spend as though there's no check. If the Fed stayed away from the bond market, the bonds would legitimately begin to go down in price to reflect the additional supplies that are coming, interest rates would rise, and Congress would at some point would have to slow down.
But there are economists on both sides of the aisle, conservative and liberal, who say that the government needs to spend, that they shouldn't check their spending very much, or is it just gone too far?
Well, you can see what the Keynesians have done now. The budget deficits are at record levels. The economy is sputtering and barely getting down the road. The Keynesian solutions aren't working. They're spending all this money, they're putting into public works, and it's still not creating the growth. In the old economy, if you put in a dollar of debt, you got about 2.5% bang in GDP. So it was like $1 debt, 2.5 ratio up. Now it's the other way. You put a dollar of debt in and you're barely getting 0.5% growth. So it's like diminishing returns. The more debt you're adding in the problem, the less you're achieving. So the economy is going to need some sort of major reset or restructuring to be successful on a long-term basis.
Okay, I want to get to that, but I got to get back to something else first. And a really basic question, who is the Fed?
Federal Reserve is our central bank. They're
our central bank. Who funds them?
They fund themselves.
Through other banks?
Through other banks. But they basically create, they create reserve fractional banking, and they create money themselves. They don't need to have anybody to give them money. They create money.
All right. So the Fed is funded by banks, and then they turn around and loan money to the banks now at basically 0%. And then the banks, when they need to get bailed out, go to the U.S. taxpayer. Then they get bailed out, and.
Well, there are several vehicles that the Fed would use if they were doing direct assistance to the banking industry like they did in 2008. They're not currently. Those programs have been somewhat scaled back because the banking industry doesn't need them, at least domestically.
Yeah.
So TARP has been pretty much folded up and put away.
Well, why would the banks need anything? Because they're getting money at 0% and they're not loaning it to anybody.
Well, exactly. The banks are able to borrow money at zero and loan it at whatever they can find.
Yeah,
in the
credit card rates are enormous these days.
Well, they've got a pretty good spread. It's pretty outrageous, and they should be doing fairly well.
Yeah,
assuming they can stay out of Europe and speculation.
Yeah, well, somebody wrote me a check for like $40 the other day, and so I went into their bank to cash it because I wasn't close to my own, and they said, "Oh, fine, here's $34." I said, "What do you mean? It's $40." They said, "Well, we're charging you $6 to cash a check." I said, "On your bank?" So I said, "Give me the check back."
Exactly.
The fees that the public is getting charged now are exorbitant. It seems to me that all of this is incredibly wrong, that the bad boys, the bad actors of the economy primarily have been banks and those tied in with the financial services, and now we're propping them up again.
Well, I'm not going to defend the U.S. banks. They can defend themselves. They have plenty of money to do that, and
they do. Yes, we have noticed that. Yeah.
The problem the banking system is that I don't think it's responsive to consumers anymore. As I said the last time I visited you, the elimination of Glass-Steagall, the allowing of national banking to occur, like when Washington Mutual folded here, it's now with Chase branches across Washington State and California. Well, all of us who put money into Chase, if you have an account there, you may or may not have had your funds traded in London recently. Those deposits, there's no guarantee. Once they go into Chase, there's no guarantee where those deposits go. And that's the issue, is that, you know, if Chase, it's not so much that Chase Manhattan or JP Morgan Chase lost whatever the number is, whether it's $2 billion or $7 billion. That's not the issue in my mind. The issue is that the $7 billion in deposits that JP Morgan had available to it were not invested back in the domestic economy on productive economic uses. They were speculating in European debt, and they lost $2.5 billion. Now, they claim that they're still making loans, and they're really good bankers, and they're trying their best to improve, to make the American economy improve. The point I have is that there's absolutely no way people sitting in New York will care what happens in Puyallup. It's just not going to happen. So we've got to find some way, in my opinion, if you want to have growth in the United States, we've got to end national banking. And we've got to create regional banks again that are responsive to the economic and social needs in each region they serve. And that system worked really well in this country for a long time.
So reinstating Glass-Steagall's not enough?
No. I think you've got to put up barriers to where they can operate. And I think regional banking would be a good step, I mean, one way to go. And I think you have to divide, you know, securities trading from banking. And let them, if they want to trade in their own capital in Europe and take those kind of risks, then let them do it mm-hmm. as securities firms.
The one thing, I know that the American taxpayer did not insure J.P. Morgan Chase's trades.
Right.
At the same point in time, the American taxpayer does insure deposits in J.P. Morgan Chase branch banking.
Right.
And so it seems to me that just from someone looking at it at the outside, that I basically am insuring J.P. Morgan Chase's unusual activities.
The issue is you just don't know. Since there's no transparency, we don't know if the deposit base was used to fund those trades in London or whether it was something else. Mm-hmm. The issue is that, I mean, since 2008, the regulators have been trying to get a handle on these over-the-counter derivatives and trying to write rules that would prevent this kind of trading from occurring and taking this kind of exposure into the U.S. banking system. The problem is that these banks refuse to believe that there's enormous risk here. So they continue to do these leveraged trades in their London branches, and by making them branch offices, they're not under the guise of or under the regulation of SFA in London or the
SFA is
the Financial Services Authority in Great Britain.
All right.
And they're offshore enough so that there's no regulator that can really tap in to see what they're doing. There's no transparency. We still don't know on the JP Morgan trade, for instance, who the counterparty was or what the size of the trade was. You know, I listened to Congress, I listened to a testimony for 2 hours. Not one of these geniuses that represent us in the Congress of the United States asked who the counterparty was or how large the loss is. I didn't hear it one time. Hmm. Or in the Senate side, for that matter. And
well, could it have been because the banking industry was funding all of their campaigns?
Well, it is. I mean, it's shocking. I mean, it's really distressing as a citizen when I found out. I went back and looked, and the financial services industry has given to Congress over $5.5 billion in donations. In the Senate Banking Committee alone, donations...
Did you say billion?
$5.5 billion, yes.
Oh, my gosh.
And in the Senate Banking Committee alone, the number is $700 million. And I listened to the Republican senators questioning Jamie Dimon, and I was appalled. They were asking him, well, can you tell us what we should do to regulate you? I mean, excuse me?
All right, but now, having heard this and watching a little bit of Jamie Dimon, who... you know, looked great on television and you
right.
know, like he was supposed to do. What does this mean to me here on Main Street?
Well, as you say, what's happened to the most American consumers is you're paying very high interest rates for the loans that you can get from the banking system, and you're paying very high fees to do business with them. And that's what it means.
So the economy is choked because of financial services?
No, that's just symptomatic of one of the issues that we're facing if you're talking about the banking industry. Mm-hmm. There are much broader issues at work in the American economy, primarily related to wages, I think. But. Mm.
Very short break. We're very fortunate to have Michael Young with us, who is a financial guru, and I say that because he's got 30 years of trading futures, and so he's had to stay up on every aspect of the economy, and he is talking with us right here about the future of our own economy while we review the past. Michael, we talked about the jobs report just a little bit ago, and that we've talked about financial services. Give me some hope, man.
Well, there is hope. I mean, eventually,
everybody will die, and so
eventually the debt's going to be liquidated at some point, and there will be growth again. But the problem is the overhang, like in the generation that needs to spend money, of the ages say 18 to 30, is that demographic? They are so burdened with student loans that their debt load is so heavy and so massive. A lot of them are now living at home with their parents.
So their debt from student loans is owed to the U.S. government for the most
Correct.
Part. The U.S. government then has gone and sold its debt significantly to China.
Mm-hmm. Well, other people, I mean, around the world.
Why don't we all just forgive each other's debts and start over?
Well, that would mean the value of that would be worthless, and you can't do that, Stan, because that would be like resetting the banking system. Nobody wants to do that.
How much are we worth now?
I don't think we have a net worth. I think we have a negative net worth.
Okay, so wouldn't it be better to start at zero than in the hole?
Well, we may end up doing that. I don't know.
But it's the
issue of the amount of debt, I mean, it's striking to me that when you talk to the American people about the level of federal spending and the level of federal debt, I mean, the deficit numbers in 1 year are so staggering. I mean, it's hard for me to get my mind around a figure like $3.5 trillion, how much yeah. money that actually is. When you think about, we've added almost $6 trillion in 4 years to the national debt, which is equivalent to what we'd spent in the previous 220. I mean, these numbers are beyond shocking. And then you look at what the Fed balance sheet has done. And pretty soon you begin questioning whether or not these are solvable numbers. And at some point in time, it's going to have to be dealt with. But the outrage is, in my opinion, is that nobody in Washington thinks there's a problem, apparently, because they continue to operate the government on continuing resolution after continuing resolution, which means no one's doing the hard work of budgeting at all. They just simply take the last year's spending, add 10%, pass another resolution, out the door they go. So there's no check on spending whatsoever. The Fed is helping to fund almost 70% of what they're spending, so there's no impact on interest rates from this behavior. So at some point, someone's got to say to these people, hey, do you guys know what you're doing? I mean, here's Maria Cantwell. She's running for re-election this year. I've not heard one commentator, not one newscaster ask her why there's not been a budget in the Senate for 3 years.
Not been a budget.
The U.S. Senate has not passed a budget in 3 years.
So we're just...
They just operate on a continuing resolution. And the House of Representatives, of course, goes along with it because they don't want to shut the government down. And so they just continue to pass these continuing resolutions.
I mean, there are some smart people in Congress. It sounds like the problem's just too hard.
Well, David Stockman sought, though, in 1982, and they fired him.
Yeah.
Stockman said, hey, you can't do this. And the Reagan administration said, we're going to do this. And he said, well, I'm leaving. And he was right. I mean, it was like the beginning of the spending ball. It won't stop now.
What if we were to turn to people who we have turned to in the past for help, into Europe? Or are they just too far gone? I mean, Germany seems to be propping up Europe right now.
Yeah, somewhat to their chagrin.
Yeah.
And the Germans have limits. I mean, the German economy is not the size of the United States economy. I mean, it's about the size of California in terms of GDP.
Mm-hmm.
So,
which is the fifth largest economy in the world.
Exactly. But you're asking a lot of the German people to take on the guarantee of all of Europe and the wild debts that have been created. The structural problems in Europe are going to be very difficult to unwind, and I don't know how they will be unwound, and it's a very big problem.
Well, here in the United States, when we got in our financial difficulties and so much of it tied to mortgage-backed securities, unwinding was something that we absolutely refused to do.
Right.
Was that because if we started unwinding things, we would find out who the bad actors are?
That's part of the problem. Part of the problem is that the amounts involved may be too staggering to imagine. The original bailout numbers being bantied around now about Spain and Italy,
mm-hmm.
to bring them up to snuff just in the first round of banking exposure is something like $600 billion. The numbers I keep hearing out of Europe on the derivative exposure are more in the trillions of exposure. And it may be symptomatic of what we saw both with MF Global and with JP Morgan Chase, that these are just the beginning of the trades that are coming unwound.
Mm-hmm.
And you can see how devastating they are. I mean, these things are, and no one knows, because there's no transparency in that market, no one knows what these people have done or how much exposure there is to the banking system. But I've heard that the European banks have levered themselves up as much as 40 to 50 to 1 on their asset base. And if they've done that,
they're toast.
Then it's very difficult.
Well, but then again, the other thing is this. What I'm kind of hearing is a shell game or a house of cards. It just seems like they're just trading paper, and they're not trading real dollars until they come to the taxpayer and they say, hey, I need help.
Well, no, they're taking real losses. I mean, the problem is that...
Real losses from what? What do they own?
Well, they're taking their paper losses. I mean, the bank's net worth, if they took these losses, would they be out of business?
Well, so, okay.
Well, they can't have that, apparently. I mean, I personally think that's one solution to the problem. But the policymakers in Europe don't think that's an issue, the correct way to solve the problem. So they're in favor of taking money out of the treasuries of these countries or creating money in the ECB. And that's a problem because the ECB has limits about how much it could borrow. That's the European Central Bank. And the problem is that these governments are beginning to lend to each other now that have no money anyway. So the bottom line is they're now resorting to the age-old principle of printing money and putting it in the banks.
Yeah, well, I've got a 9-year-old daughter. And every now and then, she'll be running along, and she'll trip and fall. And I'm not there to catch her all the time.
Right.
What it seems like to me is that all of the banks are asking to be caught all of the time to keep themselves from falling. And how can we continue to do that? Why don't we just let them go?
Well, there are many financial commentators in the world who don't understand why we're doing what we're doing in Europe, why the governments there are doing what they're doing. Mm-hmm. I think the choice they have is too painful. The policymakers are looking at the possible range of choices, and they're saying, if we write these banks down, the cost is too painful to society. They're not willing to do that. So they're trying to muddle through and fund these banks and write the losses off as they go. The problem is that no one knows how deep the hole is, and it appears to be getting wider and bigger.
Well, the other thing is that the demographic of the world population is significantly changing. Most of the wealth that was created in the world, at least of relatively recent times, was post-World War II.
That's right.
And those people are gone, and the baby boomers are retiring. And they need to be supported instead of supporting what they had before. This seems to me to be a black hole, and we can't get out.
Well, there are solutions, but you can't just, if you make the generalization and throw up your hands and say we can't deal with this, then that's not a good answer. That won't work. So then you have to say, well, what policy decisions can we make to get us down the road to solve the issues before us? And the European policymakers are trying to do that. I personally think it's a failing policy. I think in the long run, they're going to end up exactly what you're suggesting. They're going to end up writing these banks off and writing them down. If this happens, it'll impact growth tremendously. And already, the slowdown in Europe is beginning to impact our companies because Procter & Gamble, for instance, announced today that their growth rates are going to be significantly below what they were forecasting. Mm-hmm. And that's all coming, they said, from currency translations and lack of growth in developed countries. Code word Europe. So American companies that do business in Europe, and there's a lot of them that make profits there, Ford, General Motors, IBM, the list is endless. Mm-hmm. It's one of our biggest markets, and it's basically not functioning.
And we can't look to China anymore to bail us out, can we? Because China's economy itself is not going to support the rest of the world.
Well, the transparency in China is very difficult to know what's exactly happening there. The best guess of what I can tell from our analysts that we listen to tell us that there is still growth happening in China at around 7.5% to 8% GDP growth, which is still fairly good growth. Mm-hmm. But you don't know the quality of the growth, and you don't know where it's happening. Again, that's an economy that's difficult to judge. I mean, I complain in the United States about what we've done to our wage levels here because I think it's really impacting our ability to grow our economy. And my thesis is you have to grow wages before you can grow the economy. In China, they have a system there that they don't necessarily care about what they pay you. You're sent to the farm and you're going to work. And mm-hmm. if you don't like it, you get killed. And that's what you live
repressive... Well, that's a bit harsh.
It's a repressive society that nobody talks about. But, I mean, the workers at the Apple factories, there's suicides every week from people that are simply overworked and have no hope. I mean, this is not, I don't think, a good comparison to the Western economies, China. So that's why I'm saying, in discussing the Chinese economy, it's more difficult. They've made a lot of money because their wages are very, very low, and they're able to sell in the American market at very good prices. So mm-hmm. they made a lot of cash.
All right, so if you were getting out of college today with a business degree, what business would you go into here in the United States? Farming?
Farming. I said that last time I was here.
Yes.
And I still believe that the best place to make serious net worth increase is in farming. The exponential demand is there. The government wants to help you farm. It'll help you get into the business.
Yeah, with subsidies.
I mean, it's a decent business to get in, and it's a growing industry. And if you're smart, you can do very, very well.
And so you're not kidding about that, are you?
No, I'm not. I'm very serious about farming. It's I think one of the great growth industries of the future, because if you look at the demand for feed grains in the world, it's incredible. And we've been very lucky because our technology has been able to produce bumper crop after bumper crop. But one of these days, we're going to have a crop failure due to a drought or something. Mm-hmm. And you're going to see prices escalate beyond what you...
Oh, yeah, and we're going to have 8, maybe 9 billion people on the planet by the year 2050. And if we have that, then we're going to have a need for a lot more food.
We're going to need more food.
Something else that seems to be a growth industry, and we don't have a whole lot of time left, is natural gas. There's been a lot more natural gas, even though the prices are down on it. Is natural gas going to be replacing oil, and is that important to us?
It could. If policymakers made a concerted decision to do something smart to change our dependency on foreign oil, natural gas would be a very viable alternative. There's technology now that we could adapt. Boone Pickens talks about this, mm-hmm. Where we could adapt to our fleet of trucks and buses almost immediately to switch from diesel to natural gas. The problem is that there's not the will to do it. I frankly don't understand it.
Why isn't there the will to do it?
You know, it's a very good question. I think that you need to ask the policymakers, people like Patty Murray and Maria Cantwell, why they're not asking for subsidies to switch over. Because we could really end a lot of our dependency on Middle Eastern oil, which is a huge foreign policy problem for us and national security issue for us.
So it's just a lack of political will, huh?
I think we need some leadership. I think we need new leadership in the country. I think these people that can't pass budgets in 3 years, and I don't care whether they're Democrats or Republicans, who aren't willing to look at new energy policies. President Obama promised us he was going to look at seriously finding new alternative energies, and you know what we got was Solera that went bankrupt, and we're still driving around in cars using gasoline.
Well, we have 10 seconds left. Do you have a solution to all of our economic problems in 10 seconds?
I think what we need to do is raise wages, get jobs that we shipped overseas back into this country as quickly as possible, increase our manufacturing base, and reduce our debt as quickly as possible.
Well, that'll be the last word. This has been Michael Young. We'll see you right here next week on Public Exposure TV. Take care.